count on one thing. The same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. And yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Oh, yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Oh, yes, I will. Fail me now, you won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out.
Good morning, church. I hope you're having a blessed day today. Today we are going to continue in 1 Kings 17. We're going to look at Elijah some more. And what we're going to look at today is a powerful lesson. And I've mentioned it before, but I think it's time that I, you know, explain it even more in depth. We're going to talk today about the spiritual law of shutting up. And that might sound harsh or rude if you've never been a part of this ministry, but if you know anything about me, you know that I love my church and I love the people that follow this ministry. And one of the things that burdens my heart, and when I say burden, I mean it weighs heavy on me, is when the devil overcomes people, or when the devil is seeming to run rampant in people's lives. And this is almost always due to the fact of what we speak. You know, what we speak will dictate what we get. And Proverbs 18, I'm going to read this verse and then I'm going to pray. In Proverbs 18, let's go there. In Proverbs 18, verse 16, or Proverbs 18, verse 21, it says, "Death and life are in the power of the tongue, and they that love it shall eat the fruit thereof." It says, death and life are in the power of the tongue. Death and life is not in whether you sin or not. Death and life is not in the food that you eat. Death and life is not the company that you keep. It says death and life are in the power of the tongue. So what you say will affect whether you have death or whether you have life. And this is one of the most important spiritual principles in the Bible, because words have power. Words have immense, powerful meaning, and they will decide whether you have the life, the abundant life of God living in you, or if you're going to have death and turmoil and chaos in your life. So we're going to talk about this a little bit today. But before we do, I want to pray. Father, I thank you. I pray you bless everybody under the sound of my voice. Let this word become wisdom, revelation, and the knowledge of your Son. Spiritual seed sown, producing in our body, mind, will, and emotion. Transforming us by the renewing of our mind, conforming us into the image of Christ, growing us up in the measure and the stature of the fullness of Christ. God, we love you and we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, if you will go to 1 Kings 17, we're going to start here. And I just want to read this verse, and it says, "And Elijah the Tishbite, who was of the inhabitants of Gilead, said unto Ahab, as the Lord God of Israel liveth, before whom I stand, there shall not be dew nor rain these years, but according to my word. And the word of the Lord came unto him, saying, get thee hence, and turn thee eastward, and hide thyself by the brook Cherith that is before Jordan. And it shall be that thou shalt drink of the brook, and I have commanded the ravens to feed thee there. So he went and did according to the word of the Lord, for he went and dwelt by the brook Cherith that is before Jordan. And the ravens brought him bread and flesh in the morning, and bread and flesh in the evening, and he drank of the brook. And it came to pass after a while that the brook dried up, because there had been no rain in the land. Now I do want to read this other verse, and here we go. Verse 14. For thus saith the Lord God of Israel, the barrel of meal shall not waste, neither shall the curse of oil fail until the day that the Lord sendeth rain upon the earth. So, and we'll just go ahead and read. And she went and did according to the saying of Elijah, and she and he and her house did eat many days. And the barrel of meal wasted not, neither did the curse of oil fail, according to the word of the Lord, which he spake by Elijah. So Elijah has understood the principle of speaking, and what he says has power. He first declares that there will be no rain until I speak again. I have prayed in the drought. The drought has come. I have spoke according to the word of the Lord. So his words had power because he spoke and a drought came. But his words also had power because when he heard from God about going to the brook, it says he went. So he agreed with God. But then we see again that when he went into Zarephath and met the widow woman, he told her that the barrel of meal will not waste and the curse of oil will not fail. He's saying these things are going to be done. This is what I declare. And that's what happened. He understood the power of words. He understood the most important principle in the Bible, which is you don't go against your confession. Which is the power of life and death is in the tongue. It says that can fresh water and bitter water come out of the same well? And that's obviously no. You can't have both out of the same thing. And Jesus says in Matthew 12, let's go there. You're gonna love this verse. I very much love this verse. I hope you do too. In Matthew 12, Jesus said, let's read it. In Matthew 12, he said, either make the tree good and its fruit good, or else the tree corrupt and its fruit corrupt, for the tree is known by its fruit. O generation of vipers, how can ye, being evil, speak good things? For out of the abundance of the heart the mouth speaketh. A good man out of the good treasure of the heart bringeth forth good things, and an evil man out of the evil treasure bringeth forth evil things. But I say unto you that every idle word that men shall speak, they shall give account thereof in the day of judgment. For by thy words thou shalt be justified, and by thy words thou shalt be condemned. So, Jesus is telling us that words have power. We're going to have to give an account for these words, because these words come from the heart. What you really believe in the heart is shown by what you speak. Jesus said, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. Now, I'm going to get to a point about Elijah in just a second. I'm trying to lay this foundation first. Go to Mark chapter 11. Go to Mark chapter 11. Mark chapter 11 is a powerful chapter. But let's read this. And Jesus answering said unto them, have faith in God, for verily I say unto you, that whosoever shall say unto this mountain, be thou removed, be thou cast into the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe that those things which he saith shall come to pass, he shall have whatsoever he saith. Therefore I say unto you, what things soever you desire, when you pray, believe that you receive them, and ye shall have them. So, there's a spiritual law in place. And that spiritual law is saying that if you, whatever you say, and doubt not in your heart. That's the part I want to talk about today, is doubt not in your heart. Because Jesus said, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. So, I always tell people that there's a difference between doubt in your head and doubt in your heart. You can doubt in your head and not doubt in your heart. Now, what's the difference? there can be one of three different verses in your, three different people speaking in your own head. You could have your voice, your consciousness, your voice. You could hear your voice. The other voice you could hear is the voice of God. You could hear the voice of the Holy Ghost. You could hear the voice of God. So that's two different voices. Well, the third voice is the voice of the devil. He is the accuser. He's the accuser of the brethren. But he's the one that brings forth doubt into people's head. So I know a lot of people that they pray, and then they have a thought contrary to what they just prayed. So like, let's say they say, I prayed for healing. And then the next moment, I had a thought saying, well, I didn't see anything. My body didn't change, so it didn't work. Well, that's a lie. That's the devil. That's the thought of doubt. But just because you had the thought does not mean you've doubted in your heart. Remember, Mark 11:23, the only hindrance is doubt in your heart, not doubt in your head. That's a very different thing. So when you doubt in your head, you have that thought, the Bible says we cast out every high thought and vain imagination, exalting itself against the knowledge of God, and we bring it into captivity. So if the devil gives us a lie, we don't have to accept it. We could say, devil, you're a liar. I rebuke you. Get out in Jesus' name. You have no place. I bind that thought and cast it out. It is not in line with the word of God. So you can make those confessions. You can stand against it. If you resist the devil, he will flee from you. And that he will flee from you is not just he flees. It means he flees in fear. Because the power that's in you is greater than his power. So when you stand against him, he runs from you. This is powerful. I'm getting to a point about Elijah, but I'm trying to lay this foundation. That what you say, you will have. What you say, you will have. And if you cannot figure out how to bridle the tongue to make sure that you only speak life, you will be opening the door for death. Because when you speak doubt, it's because doubt has gotten into your heart. Because remember, there is doubt in your head and there's doubt in your heart. And if you doubt in your heart, then you won't have whatsoever things you desire. Whatsoever things you prayed for, the things that you spoke, you won't have if you doubt in your heart. Well, how do we know it's in the heart? How do we know if we've doubted in the heart? Well, according to Matthew 12, Jesus said, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. So if you want to know what's in somebody's heart, just listen to what they say. Because if they're speaking doubt, then doubt is in their heart. And that's an important thing to know. Because when we're evaluating our life and we're evaluating what's happening in our life, whether it be life or whether it be death, we need to know that it's based on what we say. That we have the power to control what happens in our life, whether it's life or whether it's death. Because the power of life and death is in the tongue. So we can see, or let's say it better than this. When you hear something coming out of your mouth that you've spoken, realize that's what you're going to have. If all you speak is death, you are going to have death. People say, well, I just can't help myself. That's all, you know, or I'm just, you know, I'm always speaking negatively, or, you know, I'm just trying to tell the truth. Well, you might be speaking facts, but that's not the truth. The truth is the word of God. You know, Pilate said, what is truth? The truth is the Bible. You know, if the Bible says in 1 Peter 2:24, by his stripes you were healed. If you were healed, you is healed. Then that's what you say. That's the truth. You know, if all you do is speak sickness, you're going to have sickness. You decide what happens in your life, and it's based on what you speak. Now, I'm not having a teaching on sickness today or healing. I'm having a teaching on words. So let's go to this passage in 2 Kings 4. I'm going to tie something else in with this. So in 2 Kings 4, you have a woman who... Here we go. You got a widow woman who comes to Elisha. Now Elijah, the man we're talking about with the J, is in 1 Kings 17. This is his successor. This is the man that comes after him. This man receives a double portion of the anointing that's on Elijah. comes on Elisha. Okay? This is S-H-A. The other one's J with J. And she comes to him and he tells her how to get money to pay off debt. And it's through oil. It's through gathering vessels and pouring the oil, and the oil is going to supernaturally just keep flowing. Now that's important. I'm not going to go through this whole story. But he said, as long, you know, when there's vessels there and you pour, the oil is going to keep flowing. But listen to what happened. In verse 6, it said, it came to pass when the vessels were full, that she said unto her son, bring me yet a vessel. And he said unto her, there is not a vessel more, and the oil stayed. So it wasn't until one of them confessed that there was no more that the oil stayed. That oil would have kept flowing if they would have had more vessels. But the minute they said there is no more, then the oil stopped. They had what they spoke. When they said there's no more vessels, there's no more oil. They spoke this. Now, I'm bringing this to you because I want you to think about something when it comes to 1 Kings 17. Between Elijah speaking to Ahab, to Elijah praying in the rain, it was a span of 3 years. I think it was 3 years or 3.5 years. It was in the third year that he said, go to Ahab. So we got 3 years. It's somewhere in the third year. So we got 3 years of no rain. But God provides for us in our obedience. Well, Elijah had to go to the ravens, and Elijah had to go to the widow woman. And on both of those places, he had a word from God about how he was going to be sustained. He even tells the widow woman, these things won't stop until the rain comes. Okay? So when the rain comes, then these things will stop. But until then, these things will not stop. Well, this is 3 years. And I want you to understand something. Not one time in 3 years did Elijah go against his confession. When he said this, he never went against it. He just stood on what God said. He stood on the fact that the ravens were going to provide. He didn't look up one day and go, man, I know the ravens won't come tomorrow. I bet the ravens are going to stop coming tomorrow. He never said that. Not one time. He never looked at the woman and goes, yeah, I think that thing's going to run out of meal and run out of oil. We're going to starve, you know, soon. He didn't say that. But how many people do? How many people believe God or accept a call from God and start walking out purpose with God? And then down the line, they start saying, oh, I guess God ain't providing for me. I guess God ain't doing it. You know, and they start saying all of these negative things. Listen, I tell people there's a spiritual law called the spiritual law of shutting up. Because it's better to not say anything than it is to go against your confession. Because when you speak against it, you cause the provision and the blessing to stop. Jesus said, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. And then whatsoever things you desire, when you say it, believe, doubt not in your heart. Well, when doubt starts coming out of your mouth, that shows that there is doubt in your heart. And I want you to see this when we talk about Elijah's life and when we talk about somebody who's walking in great faith, that and not only walking in great faith, but they're walking in obedience to God. You know, everybody wants to know, how do you do it? How do you do it? How do you do it? And the answers are super simple. You know, you speak what God says. You do what God says. You walk with God. And it's so simple, but it feels so complicated for most people because they're so used to just speaking however they feel. Whatever thought comes in their head, they speak it out of their mouth. And Jesus says that when you speak those things, it's not just you thought it. You've let it get in your heart. It has become a hindrance to you receiving from God. Because you're speaking life and you're speaking death. And when you speak life and then you turn around and doubt in your heart and let that come out of your mouth, now you've spoken death and you've contradicted faith and you're not going to receive it. What I want you to see about the man Elijah is Elijah for 3 years never went against his confession. And if you just keep reading and reading and reading, when Elijah spoke, he believed what he said and he stood on it. He didn't go against it. I mean, how many of you? Okay, so it's 3 years, ravens and widow woman, 3 years total. We could say it's 1 year river, 2 years widow woman. 2 years river, 1 year widow woman. We could say year and a half river, year and a half widow woman. So either way, let's say it's a bare minimum of a year. Elijah is sitting beside a brook, and every day ravens are bringing him food in the morning and in the evening. And not one time does he say it's gonna stop. Because if he says it stops, it stops. The same way in 2 Kings 4, the woman said, "Bring me a vessel," and the son says, "There is no more." Over. The oil stayed at that moment. He got what he said. When he said it was done, it was done. If Elijah would have said, the ravens are gonna stop bringing me food tomorrow, then guess what? The ravens would have stopped bringing him food. He would have died out there. You know, he had to agree with God, and he couldn't contradict what he had already said and the confession that he made. That's powerful. And I make this point because so many people want to learn how to walk this life out. And I'm gonna give a personal testimony real quick. You have to live at the level of faith that you're at. You know, so many people ask me, they're like, I said my confession on healing. But I still don't feel well, or they still have this doubt. I tell people all the time, you have to live at the level of faith that you're at. I'm gonna give a personal testimony. When I was in college, one of the first things I ever experienced from God was a miracle on healing. God, I used to get a sinus infection twice a year, and one day it started to come on. But I knew there was healing. I knew God wanted me healed. So I decided to pray right there and believe, and I got healed, and it never happened again. And that's 9 years ago. It's never happened again. I used to do it twice a year for 10 years straight, and it's never happened again. Now, there was a time when the devil threw sickness at me when I was in college, and I refused. I was not going to the doctor. There was no way. Anyway, I was not going to take medicine. I refused. I decided to dig my heels in. I was going to believe God. Well, it went on for about 2 weeks, fighting a battle over and over and over. And to the point, I lost my voice completely. I literally could not say anything. People would talk to me and I'd try to open my mouth, and literally I had lost my vocal cords. I couldn't say anything. And that's not good because I couldn't rebuke the devil. I couldn't praise God. I literally couldn't say anything. And I was in a rough spot, and luckily I had some great men and women of God around me, and one of my buddies ministered healing to me, and I got healed, and I was like, man, like I was really trying to receive this on my own, and it was very detrimental. It didn't do me any good. I wasn't at the level of faith yet to be able to just live in divine health and receive healing directly from God. I wanted to, but I wasn't there yet, and I didn't do it right. I wouldn't say that's a good approach. I wouldn't say losing your voice so you can't praise God is a good thing. That was what I would call immaturity. But around this time, I learned this spiritual law. I was reading the Word a lot. I listened to a lot of sermons. If you don't know me personally, I read a lot of the Bible, watch a lot of sermons. And God was teaching me the spiritual law about my confession, about how not to go against my confession on healing, and that I would never get sick, how to walk in divine health. And I would say from then until now, that's 5, 6, 7. I would say that's been 7 years ago. I have only gotten sick one time in 7 years. And 5 of those years, I was completely backslidden. I wasn't even walking with God, but I still never got sick. When COVID happened, I never got sick. When sickness would come rampant, I never would get sick. I decided to believe God on healing even when I was backslidden. Because I mean, God does not take away something he's given. So I knew the spirit was inside of me. I still knew I had healing. So I just never, I never backed off on my confession. Now, a very personal thing is this past week, I was, you know, it always wants to come out. And I happened to slip up and I let it come out. I said, my body feels worn down. It's against my confession, but it just wanted to come out so bad I let it. And now I've had to war a warfare against sickness to stay healed. But I didn't have to do that if I would have just controlled what I said. The same way with Elijah. Elijah had to control what he said so that the provision would keep flowing and would never stop. The way you walk in health, the way you walk in divine provision is to bridle the tongue so that way you only speak life. And if you can't speak life and there's nothing else to say, then just shut up. Don't say anything else. Because the minute you say it, you're going to let it in your life, and you don't want that in your life. And we're out of time today, so Father, I thank you. I pray you bless everybody under the sound of my voice. Let this word become wisdom, revelation, and the knowledge of your Son. Spiritual seed sown, producing in our body, mind, will, and emotion. I declare healing and victory over your life. I bind the devil and cast him out now in Jesus' name. Be healed, be set free in the mighty name of Jesus. Father, I thank you for it. I declare it all done. In Jesus' mighty name I pray. Amen and amen. Well, church, I love you. I pray you come back tomorrow. We'll be here at 9 a.m. And if you are in our discipleship class, we will have class at 7 p.m. tonight dealing with tongues. And we will see you tonight at 7 p.m.
Count on one thing, the same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. And yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Oh, yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Oh, yes, I will. Fails, will not fail me now. You won't fail.